Good morning. I hope you are well. But bear with me. My screen has done something totally weird today, and I'm not sure why that is the case. I still have a spinning circle of doom, but I think I'm live. It's Wellness Wednesday. I hope you are well where you are, and it's also Mental Health Week in many parts of the country. But obviously, I'm in Queensland, so I'm tagging Mental Health Week Queensland in most of my posts this week. And I decided to do two things for Mental Health Week. Firstly was to show up on my personal page each day talking about a different aspect of health and well-being that's important to me, and that I practice, to share what I can, and so far that's had nice feedback. I also challenged myself to write a new poem, which I have. I'm going to share that with you today. It's called A Poem for Well-Being. And generally to kind of get out and about and talk with as many people as I can about different aspects of wellness, which is what I'm passionate about. So I had a chance to do that in air on Saturday. Saturday it was, at the Coffee and Connections event hosted by Burdekin Shire Council. And then I was invited to a feel-good expo on Monday morning at a local school. And so I had a chance to talk to children as well as parents and teachers. And I had some really lovely chats with children actually about how, you know, books and reading and certain types of books can help us overcome challenges. And there was a book that I posted on my page the other day called The Cheeky Brain. And The Cheeky Brain is written by a child psychologist based here in Townsville. And it helps children understand how our brains can hold us back and be cheeky and tell us we can't do things when in fact we can, or that we should be scared of things when in fact we probably shouldn't. So that's a big principle of mindfulness, and it's obviously written in language that children can understand. But I'm going to touch on that a bit today in terms of adults, because in all of the opportunities that I have to get out and about and meet people all over the place, and talk to people about many different things, people share stuff with me, and that's a privilege when people want to share things with you about their life or their challenges or their personal things. And there's common themes that I encounter regardless of where I go. So, you know, it doesn't matter where I am in the world, I see and hear from people common things. And I also know for myself that what's true for me is often true for others. And there's a quote in my book, which is nearby, is someone else just like me. So the common themes that I encounter when it comes to people suffering with their well-being are childhood trauma, whether that be abuse, neglect, or something else. Feelings of low self-worth and no self-love, that's a very common theme. Grief following the loss of a loved one or a child, and in many women's cases it can be a miscarriage or loss of an infant. That comes up a lot. Overthinking, ruminating, and negative thinking. And it's interesting because when I point these terms out to people, they're not even aware that they do it, but they do it to themselves because they haven't learned not to. So those are three things that impact our well-being a lot when it comes to how we think and how we allow our brains and our cheeky brains to run riot, causing us to feel and do unhealthy things as a result. Being too busy to be well. We can all have that claim to fame from time to time. I'm too busy to do this. I'm too busy to look after myself. I'm doing everything for everyone else. That's a story that we tell ourselves. So we're too busy to be well. Holding on to long-term stress and being unwell from the toxic buildup in the body. So stress causes toxins to build up in our body. And on top of that, many of us live a relatively sedentary life. So we're sitting all day in the office, we're lying down sleeping, we're sitting down to eat, and we're not moving our bodies constantly throughout the day, which also causes toxins to build up in our body because our lymphatic system becomes very sluggish. So moving all throughout the day is a way to do that. But also knowing that when we have had long-term stress and trauma, those toxins build up inside your body, destroy our gut health, which then means we can't process foods and nutrients properly, we can't produce healthy hormones, and there's a massive knock-on effect to that. So the impact of stress and long-term stress and toxicity in the body is really important and not discussed enough. Our belief systems that are not helpful, healthy, or conducive to learning information that could help change things. So sometimes we have to unlearn belief systems that are keeping us stuck or that are stopping us from actually taking care of ourselves. I can give you thousands of examples about that. I'm not going to just now. Feelings of isolation and being alone in life. So regardless of how connected we are in the world right now, many people feel lonely and feel isolated. And that can also be true for a lot of women, specifically when you're doing the predominant role in terms of caring for the kids and feeling as though you don't have people to help you. You feel very isolated and often feel alone. And then finally, one of the big things is that people don't take accountability for their health and well-being because they feel and think that someone else can fix them. So it's always someone else that can come and fix me as opposed to me being in charge or starting to learn or to be able to fix myself. So you need to decide to be well first and foremost, whether that's losing weight, getting fit, learning how to overcome certain types of thinking that's keeping you stuck. The things I talked about, the five pillars of well-being, what are we thinking, feeling, eating, drinking, and doing? Well, we're responsible for those five things, so we can start to change our health and well-being. So all of those things that I've just described seriously impact our physical health, obviously our mental health, our emotional health, and of course our spiritual health, because we don't go about our day feeling love and joy and compassion and grace when we're feeling angry and bitter and sad and lonely and so on and so forth. So that's important for spiritual health. And here's some interesting things that I've learned as I was very good at ruminating, very good at overthinking, and often quite good at negative thinking. So I pat myself on the back because I now know how not to do those things because they were keeping me stuck and keeping me unwell. So our body doesn't know the difference between a thought and an event. So if I think about sad things, my body responds in a way, releasing chemicals that keep me feeling sad physiologically. If I think angry things, my body will release adrenaline because I'm getting ready to fight someone. If I think about, basically the chemical and physiological reactions directly impacted by the thought that we have, which generates the emotion, which then generates the behavior. So this is where we need to start going backwards and unpicking things. If we think about love, we produce dopamine. We think about angry things, we produce adrenaline, and those two hormones are opposite each other, and they have an opposite chemical reaction inside our body. Too much adrenaline for too long, as in feeling too sad, too angry, too fed up for too long, affects your immune system, and that's how we then become sick. Our organs become malnourished because we start to suffer with all kinds of health conditions when we're living in a state of stress. Because when you're living in a state of stress, all of your energy is in your outer extremities and your internal organs become malnourished of oxygen and nutrients, etc. And that also builds then toxic buildup in your body. And you have aches and pains and inflammation and you just feel shit, basically. So that's something that we need to be very mindful of. So three key things that I tend to point to when we're starting to suffer or becoming curious about all of this is notice what you're thinking about. And that's the key aspect of mindfulness. We have 70,000 thoughts a day, 98% of them we have before. What is it that you spend 98% of your time thinking about? And because then you can start to question your script. You can ask yourself, oh, why am I thinking this? I notice that I'm thinking about this a lot. I notice that I'm feeling upset. I notice this, this, this. When you start to notice, that's a key skill to learn in respect of mindfulness. The other thing is to come to terms with your trauma. So I talked about, different types of trauma, whether it's childhood trauma or adult trauma or grief trauma, coming to terms with it, and understanding the impact that it's had in your life. Will allow you to move forward, and forgiving, because you don't need to, when you forgive, you start to function differently. We can get very stuck in our story and we can relive day after day after day that trauma. And as I've said, your body doesn't know the difference between a thought and event. So if you live day after day after day with that same trauma, then you're going to be repeating that physiological reaction in your body. You can't allow yourself to be well. So that's where we need to start to recognize the impact of the trauma. the thing that the lessons that we got from it in our life, the role that it's played for us, and how we want to move forward with our health and well-being. And those are really crucial things. Recognizing that that your health is your responsibility, and we can choose to be stressed, we can also choose to be ignorant, and we can also choose to be stuck in an unhealthy cycle that's actually harming us. So if we want to break the cycle, or we want to change something, or we want to flip the script, or we want to create something new, we actually need to understand, you know, what is it that we're doing to ourselves, and to take accountability for that. And when we're responsible for our health and well-being, and we're accountable for what we think and what we feel and what we do, what we eat, what we drink, all of those things can help us little by little by little improve our well-being over time. It's just very, very simple things that we can do. So in saying all of that, a book came out, I think it's early this year, by Oprah Winfrey and Bruce Perry, and it's called What Happened to You. Now, each of us have stuff that's happened to us, and it can be from the very beginning of time to up until more recently. And if nothing has ever happened to you, my feeling on that is it just hasn't been your turn yet. And sadly, in life, we all have to suffer things because stuff happens to us all the time. So whether it's happened to you as a child or an adolescent or an adult, you know, you've been bullied, you've been victimized, you've been abused by, you know, a loved one or a partner or so on and so forth, all of that stuff happens to us. So in asking yourself, okay, what happened to me? And this book, What Happened to You, is basically helping you identify the things that happened to you that may then be resultant on how you're living your life now. What are your choices? What are your behaviors? And so on and so forth. I'll give you a very quick example. Recently, I met someone who told me that her daughter was in rehab for alcoholism. And we chatted about that, and I passed her a book written by my friend Carol Jones, who's 20 years sober, and she passed that book on. And but what came about as a result of that conversation was the fact that this person who'd actually been sexually abused as a child, and when she went on to share that information, she wasn't listened to. So generally, people who are abused as children, they go on harming themselves because they don't feel loved. They go on abusing themselves and make unhealthy choices in their life because they feel that they have low self-worth, and so on and so forth. And if you've read recently, I interviewed Maria Hutchison, who obviously has written a book also about that, because it talks about how, you know, all of the unhealthy choices that we make in our life, whether it's alcohol addiction, shopping addiction, sex addiction, drug addiction, many addictions can be linked back to childhood trauma, because we suffered abuse and neglect and we don't know how to take care of ourselves. We go on abusing ourselves. But that's just a very, very simple example of where you can link what happened to me to where you are in your life right now. And you can start to ask yourself some more meaningful questions. And some of those things I like to think of the seven whys. Why am I feeling like this? Why did that happen to me? Why is this? Why is this? Why is this? And if you can ask all of your whys, then you'll get to a point of acceptance, forgiveness, and start to make different choices and different decisions so much quicker. So those are really my key aspects when it comes to health and well-being. What happened to you, the common themes that come up in terms of wellness in society, really, and what I've kind of experienced for myself along the way as well. So I hope you found that really useful. I'm going to share for you now my poem called A Poem for Wellbeing. Are you ready? So it's called A Poem for Wellbeing. What is wellbeing? I have no clue. Is it bubble baths or massages? And affirmations too. Is it sitting with a thought that I am just enough? Or is it going to work and acting all tough? Do I have to pretend that I eat clean and look lean? Or can I veg out and space out and just go unseen? I'm curious about this thing called well-being. I'm not a buzzword person, but it's all I keep hearing. I want to sit in silence and stare at the trees, eat cupcakes and ice cream and shed all those tears. I want buckets of coffee and a space to call mine. I want to sleep through the night and wake up to the sunshine. I'm sick of the chores and running around. I don't get time to ponder things so profound. I searched some expert advice and spent some time being nice. And after all that I see, it's just up to me. I'm the boss of my wellness, the owner of my brain. I'm the person in charge of this uncontrollable freight train. So I've jumped into the driver's seat and blew the horn. I'm on the Wellbeing Express and I've just been reborn. So that's my poem called A Poem for Wellbeing. I'll paste it in the notes below. If you like it, you can share it. So what's happening this week? Sunday, I've got an event here in Townsville at the Drill Hall Studio. It's a fundraising event with Wild Heart Sanctuary and the two artists that have helped me on my Bobby book, which is just up there. And we've got free pony rides for kids. We'll have a book reading. There'll be lots of beautiful art displayed. And it really is a chance to come out with the family, have a nice time, hear some stories and catch up and support the great work that's done at Wild Heart Sanctuary. Next Friday, the 22nd, retreat number 3 starts at Mission Beach. Very joyfully can say that it's full, so we have no space for this year, but there'll be 2 retreats in 2022 with dates published soon. And I think that's everything. So if you want to have a chat about your well-being, drop me a message. I hope you've found something useful in today's information and also the poem. And I'm looking forward to seeing you again soon. Remember, it's Mental Health Week. Take care of yourself. Mind, body, spirit approach to life will give you what are you thinking, eating, feeling, drinking, and doing, those 5 things. All right. Love you lots. Take care. Bye.